All right, looking pretty good. Let's just put the finishing touches on that. Oh, hi there. I'm Elizabeth.
And I'm Erin.
And we're educators with Colorado Parks and Wildlife. And today we're here at one of my favorite mountain parks, Golden Gate Canyon State Park, where you can hike, fish, camp, and just plain explore. You caught me doing one of my favorite things, playing in the snow.
Today, let's dive deeper into this frozen stuff all around us and ask, what is snow? What are you doing, Elizabeth?
I'm trying to get a better look at the snow.
This might help.
Oh, thanks.
Oh wow, that does look a lot better. Come take a look.
If you take a close look at each snowflake, you will see that they're all unique.
How did they get that way?
Well, it all starts up in the clouds. Water droplets in the clouds begin to freeze to particles of dust or some other matter at about 32 degrees Fahrenheit or below. As these tiny particles of ice move through the clouds, more water droplets freeze to it, forming the ice crystals of the snowflake. Eventually, a snowflake forms and is heavy enough to fall to the ground.
I guess those dust particles in the snowflake explain why snow does not always taste that great. But why are they all different?
Well, to answer your question, temperature has a lot to do with the different shapes you see. Higher temperatures form needle-like crystals, and lower temperatures form plate-like crystals. Also, since it can take about 100,000 droplets of water vapor to make each snowflake, there are many ways that the droplets can arrange themselves around the snowflake. But there is one thing that all snowflakes have in common. They all have six sides.
I've heard that. Why?
It's all due to the way ice forms. When water freezes, the tiny molecules always form a hexagon.
Wow, with all this talk of freezing, I'm getting cold. Let's go inside. Snowflakes are so cool, but it sure does get cold out in the snow. How do wildlife handle it?
Well, just like we can layer up with our jackets and our hats, wildlife can too. Here, I'll show you.
We are going to need 2-gallon-sized zip-top bags, 4 tablespoons of shortening or lard, tape, ice, it can be cubed or crushed, and a bucket of water. I have in front of me a bucket filled with ice and water, and this represents Colorado's winter. Oh, that's cold. Over here, I have a zip-top bag filled with lard, and then another one inside it to protect my hand. You can put some tape around it too to keep the bags together. Make sure that lard spread around your hand so that way when you put your hand in the water, it's completely covering it. So when I dip my hand in the water now, I can barely feel it. And that's because that fat, that layer, acts like insulation for the animal to be able to survive that winter. So with the fat and growing a thicker layer of fur, Colorado's wildlife are able to handle that colder temperature during the winter. Of course, it's like when we layer up to go outside by wearing jackets, hats, and mittens. For example, the temperature on the thermometer inside this cabin is 72 degrees Fahrenheit. But let's do a little experiment. What if we put one thermometer inside my mitten and another thermometer inside a mitten that I'm wearing? We'll give it a few minutes and see if there's a difference. All right, so the mitten itself is 72 degrees Fahrenheit, while the mitten I'm wearing is 78 degrees. That means that our bodies supply the heat, and the mitten works to trap that heat, prevents it from escaping into the air, and keeps us nice and warm.
And we aren't the only ones looking for shelter to stay warm.
That's right. Animals like rabbits and bears will dig burrows and dens underground to stay warm. Just like fat, the ground is also an insulator from cold. But not only is the ground warm, a thick enough layer of snow can also help. Snow can act like a blanket because when it's about 6 inches deep, the air beneath it doesn't get colder than 32 degrees Fahrenheit.
Some animals might sleep under the snow, but others are active, such as mice. You can even find evidence, such as footprints and even tunnels. The heat from the earth changes the composition of the snow at the bottom, transforming snowflakes closer to the ground into ball-like crystals that are easier for small animals to push aside. Tunneling through the snow allows these creatures to travel and find food in relative warmth. They also create ventilation tunnels to get fresh air so that they can breathe.
Tunnels offer protection from predators such as coyotes, foxes, and hawks.
So the next time you're outside in the snow, look for signs of animals. You never know who might be walking around outside this time of year.
When the snow falls this winter, there are tons of ways to have snow much fun. When indoors, think about a nature-inspired craft like making your own snowflake or drawing your favorite Colorado wildlife.
I see what you did there. When outside, you can try making a snow creature or even building a snow cave. For more ideas of things to do outside any time of year, check out Great Outdoors Colorado's 100 Things to Do Before You're 12 list. Check out the link in the description.
Thanks for watching.